And I bake it normally, you know, in a milk can or in a bucket, you know. And we do that in a bucket when we are going to have it for the buffet, for example. But feel like home, just come and taste it and just help yourself, you know, and just feel like home and, you know, whatever you like, with herring or just butter, it's really good. And it is baked 100% right. If it's really dark and thick, then it has been cooked too long. You feel it's really a bit sticky, but that makes it even better. So try it. Don't be shy. All right. I'm gonna tell you a secret.
Oh.
Well, without any cameras. Because I was raised up here. We did a lot of things that we are not allowed to do. So when you go up on the hot springs and you will see a little hot spring, it's with a color like blue, beautiful. It's like a, I don't know, it's a, I don't know what you call it. You know, when you see a horse, it's like white and white. It's called Gliese, you know, or a glasses. The hot spring is just like that, but it's called Gliese up there, just above from Stockard. We bathe there. We go and bathe, but never try it. And don't even try to touch the hot spring, because if you touch the wrong hot spring, you will burn yourself. I promise. It's over 120 degrees.
How about the one that's flowing down by the road?
Well, it, you know, because it's floating away, a little bit far away, so, well, it is warm.
So I can touch it?
Little, very, very, you know, yeah. We make all sorts of kind of bread, but just inside, you know. But this one is just like an old traditional bread, how we did it. And we've been baking from 1927.
In the next hundreds of thousands of years, the water temperature here is going to cool down, and eventually, yeah, nothing is going to be happening here any longer. So the stuff that was in the middle of that rose out of the sea 40 to 70 million years ago has now been pushed up to the edges.
Here in our greenhouses, and after that we go to our stable and have a look at the horses.
Here we are growing tomatoes all year round, and it can maybe sound a little bit strange to be picking tomato every day of the year in Iceland, because as you know, we have very long, dark and cold winter. But with the help of the nature, we can make it possible, both by using the heat from the ground to warm up our houses, and also to use our electricity to make light to search for the plants every day of the year. You have maybe heard that we have a very special horse in Iceland, that we only have one kind of horse, which you call the Icelandic horse. We haven't imported any horses for 1,000 years, so it's a very clear bloodline. And we think that in the beginning, when the Vikings, the settlements came here to Iceland, that was in the year 900-1000, they maybe brought 4, 5, 6 different types of horses. It became the Icelandic horse. As the Icelandic horse have many specialities, his maybe most famous speciality is that he have 5 different gaits. You know, all horses, they have at least 3 gaits. They can all walk, trot, and gallop. But the Icelandic horse have a gait which is called a tölt, and the pace, the flying pace. And that's a bit unique that a one horse can do all these 5 different gaits. It's not a big horse, but it's a very strong horse. He can easily carry a big man for a long distance. He's easy to train. Usually we start to train them when they are 4 years old. And we like them to be a little bit wild when we start in the beginning. But after a couple of weeks, they really like to work with you. They are really fast learning and they really like to be around human beings, big characters. It's a colorful horse breed. Almost every color which you can find, you can find it in the Icelandic horse.
Our driver's name is Dory, so this is Dory as well.
And faster with the seat and the feet, he goes into a tölt. A tölt is a 4-beated gait. You can count 1, 2, 3, 4. Tölt is the gait which the Icelandic horse is so famous for. It's a very nice gait to sit on.
For us, the first part was much more better, much better, so much better really. And that started at the 20th of March, just before midnight. At that time in the middle of the night, they didn't know where exactly the eruption was located, so they evacuated the whole area for the first time. But then the next day people were allowed to go back home already because it was clear and obvious that the eruption was not happening underneath the ice but next to the glacier, and that those fissures had, in the first days only the first fissure had opened up, the second one came a little later. Really came worse off, there was a lot of ash all over the place, people had to leave their homes twice again, and that was the first, especially hard for the farmers. This is a very agricultural area with plenty of farms, and they had to leave their livestock. And here is where the family.
standing around the most important artifact in the whole museum, this boat here, was built in 1855. And it was used as a fishing boat, mainly, but also sometimes as a trading boat. And you couldn't, of course, wear them like this. So in order to make them softer and also waterproof, they soaked them in fish oil, hence the name oil skins.
Oh.
And imagine that great smell when they were granted. Yes. And the war was spun. And normally, it was not until around 1750 that the spinning wheel was introduced to Iceland. But still, even after that, it was in many ways much more easier to use a hand spindle because you didn't need a lot of wood to make it. It was mobile, you could take it around, and you didn't need a lot of space to store it. You could store it everywhere. And in those days, was worth the equivalent of at least one cow. Artifacts or values of artifacts were often not measured in gold or money, but in the equivalences of cows. And cows were scarce in Iceland, really precious. And a saddle worth a cow was a fortune that not each woman could afford. But look at the beautiful, beautiful decoration here. They were also made of wood. You can imagine they were not particularly comfortable for the women because they sat completely sideways on the horse and rode like this with nothing to hold on to. They couldn't steer the horses and could never ride alone, but were always accompanied by men who would pull the women's horses.
That's great.
Yeah, here it is.
Hello, where are you? People,
sorry.
Are you waiting for the boat?
I'm
sorry. I lost them.
One piece of animal bone. Pig bones were very common in other countries, but they didn't have a lot of pigs in Iceland, so they used horse bones or cow bones for it.
Mm.
You had to drill two holes through and then put a rope on each side.
Huh.
And you just simply let me pretend my hand to be my foot or my shoe. Had to tie it around your shoe and you could go skating.
Simple as that.
They are actually quite slippery, so you could run relatively fast on them. In Icelandic we call it Fjallaköttur, which translates into the wooden cat. You can see the little wire underneath. The whole mechanism was held up by a tiny little pin under my left hand. And then you had to stick cheese onto the wire, so the mouse went under. Tried to get the cheese off the wire, turned on the mechanism and just listen and see what happened to the poor mouse.
Oh,
squashed.
Mr. Thomas is just around the corner and he's ready and willing to play.
Ring, 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 ring.